When we first learn about Taylor polynomials, we usually learn that they're useful for estimating complicated expressions, although at the time, we probably had no idea why we would want to do this. There are tons of applications actually, but maybe a simple use case is that it helps computers evaluate certain functions. Most of us probably don't think that much about how the natural log function is computed. We just plug a number like 1.1 into our calculator and it spits out an answer. But what if you can't use a calculator and you had to estimate this using a pen and paper? This is where Taylor series can be helpful. The cubic Taylor expansion at 1 is this polynomial. So we can plug 0.1 into here and it gives us a pretty good estimate. This estimate is easy for computers to do because we're just adding and multiplying. So Taylor series is very important for evaluating these functions. Optimization is another huge application area for Taylor series. You might have learned about Newton's method when you took calculus. It's usually presented as a root-finding algorithm, meaning we want to find the point where this function returns zero. So for this function, it's at these two red points. Of course, we can easily solve this algebraically. One of the roots is the square root of 2, and the other one is the negative of that. But what if we want to know what this is in decimal form? This is where Newton's method comes in. The basic idea of this algorithm is we start at some initial estimate like x equals 0.5, and then find the tangent line to the function there. This line intersects the x-axis, and this point of intersection becomes our new estimate. Then, we draw a tangent line for the function at the new estimate, find its intersection with the x-axis again, and then continue like this until we converge at a root. It only takes a few iterations to converge to 1.4142, which is basically the decimal form of the square root of 2. Computers can use Newton's method to calculate square roots and other related functions very quickly. Now, there's actually an equivalent form of Newton's method that people are less familiar with, but which makes it easier to generalize to higher dimensions, which will be our goal for the rest of this video. Consider integrating this function. The function on the right is an antiderivative. The points where the derivative for the new function is zero, which are called critical points, are exactly the roots of the derivative. These critical points are usually local minima or maxima, but not always. When we took a tangent line in the original function, it corresponds to finding in the new function the second order Taylor polynomial. Then, finding where the tangent line crosses the x-axis is equivalent to finding the critical point for this quadratic function. So we can think of Newton's method as an optimization algorithm that tries to find a function's critical points by continually taking a quadratic Taylor polynomial, optimizing that, and then repeating until we converge. Now, in real life, most functions we encounter have multiple variables. Local optima, like this local minimum here, also occur at critical points, but a critical point is defined a bit differently in higher dimensions. Instead of the derivative being zero, we need all partial derivatives to be zero, which implies the gradient vector is zero. Geometrically, this means the tangent plane is flat at that point. We found these critical points using Newton's method before when we only had one variable functions. For minimization problems, we just repeatedly found quadratic Taylor polynomials and minimized that until we converged. We can try to do a similar thing here, but we first need to understand what a quadratic Taylor polynomial even is for a multivariate function. Before we look at quadratic polynomials, these are linear polynomials, which are just ordinary planes. They're composed of these linear terms a1x and a2y, which both have a degree of 1, and a constant term a0, which has a degree of 0. These ai terms are all constants. X and y are the variables. Quadratic polynomials are a bit more complicated in that they have these additional terms x squared and y squared, as well as these cross terms x times y. For all of these terms, either the power is 2 or the sum of the powers is 2. Graphically, if we take a slice of this curve, it looks like the usual parabola. Like single variable quadratics, these quadratics can also be upside down, where each slice is an upside down parabola. In addition, somewhat unique to higher dimensions is that we can also have these saddle-shaped quadratics that look like Pringles, where some slices have a parabola pointing up, and some slices have a parabola pointing down. So, a quadratic Taylor polynomial means, given a point, we want to approximate this function locally at that point using a quadratic surface. If we can find this Taylor polynomial, we can try to use Newton's method like before. So the real question is, how do we derive this quadratic Taylor polynomial? Alright, to answer this question, I'm going to give you something to think about. Let's say you don't know what this function is. And now I want you to estimate the value at this blue point, which is x equals 2.3, y equals 4.6. And all I'm going to tell you is that the function value at this red point, which is at 2.4, is minus 24. What's your best guess for the blue point's value? Now, after giving it some thought, you really don't have much information to go off of. Since the two points are kind of close, you might guess that the blue point is also around minus 24, which is a pretty reasonable guess given the lack of information. Things change when I give you more information. Like if I give you the gradient at the red point, there's a lot more you can do now. With the gradient, you can find the directional derivative in the direction towards the blue point. Remember that the directional derivative is the dot product between the gradient and a unit length direction vector. Here, this direction points from the red point to the blue point. This is around 5.37. If we look at this slice of the function, we can form this one-dimensional parametric curve, and we can call this function g. We can define the input t as the distance away from the red point along this curve. So at t equals 0, g of 0 is just the value at the red point. The distance from the blue point to the red point is roughly 0.67, so g of 0.67 gives the value at the blue point. Now, we can find the tangent line at the red point and use that as an estimate for the blue point. The tangent line approximation for the blue point at 0.67 is going to be g of 0 plus g prime of 0 times 0.67. g of 0 is the red point's value, which is f of 2.4 and is minus 24. g prime of 0 is precisely this directional derivative we calculated before. Working this out, we get an estimate of minus 20.4. This should be a bit more accurate than what we had before because now we're using the gradient information in addition to the function value. We can use this process more generally. If b is a vector representing the blue point, the function at b is approximately the function at the red point, which we denote as r, plus the directional derivative, which is the gradient at the red point, times the unit direction towards b, all multiplied by the distance between the two points. These distances cancel out, so we have this expression. Now, b and r work for any two points. If b equals b1, b2, and r equals r1, r2, we can plug this into our expression. If we also write out the gradient and then expand the dot product, we get this expression. F sub x and f sub y are the partial derivative terms. This function in terms of b1 and b2 is a plane because we don't have any degree 2 terms. This is actually the first order Taylor polynomial and also the tangent plane at the red point. Now let's derive the second order Taylor polynomial. Back to this one-dimensional slice. We originally took a tangent line, but what if we formed the quadratic Taylor polynomial for the slice at the red point? You can see that this looks like a better fit, so we should get a better estimate for the blue point. For the quadratic Taylor estimate, we have the linear estimate plus this extra term, 1 half g double prime of 0 times 0.67 squared, which remember is the distance between the two points squared. Remember from before that g of 0 is minus 24 and g prime of 0 was the directional derivative, which was around 5.37. Now, suppose we know the second derivative as well, and it's equal to 12. Then this whole expression evaluates to minus 17.7, which is our new estimate for the blue point. The actual function value at the blue point is minus 17.47, so this is a pretty good estimate. Now, this estimation we just did can also be generalized to any two points B and R, similar to what we did before. Now, this might look a little scary, but I'll break this down for you. G of 0.67 is just the function value at the blue dot, but this point B can be any other point. The same holds for the red point. R is where we do the Taylor expansion, and it can also be some other point. The yellow term is the derivative along the slice of the function at the red point, which is also the directional derivative. The green term is the distance between the two points, which in our example is 0.67, but in general is the distance between B and R. The new term is the purple term. This is the second derivative along the slice of the function. We can get this by multiplying the direction vector with this matrix H, which is the Hessian, with the direction vector. So this is the second derivative analog of the directional derivative. If you're curious, I made a previous video on this, which I'll put in the descriptions below. These distances cancel. This is the second order Taylor polynomial written in matrix form. We can also write out the gradient and the Hessian. Note that fxx, fxy, and fyy are the partial second derivatives. When the second order partial derivatives are continuous, then fxy is equal to fyx. If we assume this with some more algebra, the Taylor polynomial turns into this. Now that we have the second order Taylor polynomial, we can finally do Newton's method. Newton's method consists of starting at an initial point x0, y0, and then forming this quadratic Taylor polynomial, which we'll call g. Then we find the critical point for g, which is where the gradient is 0. This means we need to set the partial derivatives to 0. We have two equations and two unknowns, so we can solve for x and y. This gives us the next point, and then repeat these steps until we converge. Visually, this is what Newton's method is doing at a high level. It repeatedly forms the quadratic Taylor polynomial and finds its minimum if we're minimizing and maximum if we're maximizing. However, sometimes this method doesn't converge. But if it does converge, it converges very quickly. But that's a topic for another day. Thanks for watching, and if you like this, subscribe for more videos like this. See you next time.